It's my pleasure to introduce Ming Mei, co-founder and CEO of GLP. Since the founding of the company in 2009, Ming has built GLP into the leading provider of logistics solutions globally. GLP is one of the largest real estate and fund managers in the world, with over $60 billion in assets under management. So let's take us back in time. As I understand it, you completed your first property transaction, helping your family acquire a restaurant when you were rather young. Can you talk us about that?
First real estate transaction was I was 13, but I stepped back. So I was born in China. But going to the U.S., my dad had to start from scratch. So the first thing he can figure out how to do is work in the Chinese restaurant to learn how to cook for $900 a month. And then after a year learning how to cook, we had to go and buy a restaurant. And my dad didn't speak English, so I went into the bank and negotiate the first mortgage. So we got we paid a deposit of 30%. After we took over the building, we went inside, tear up every wall in the building because we didn't need those walls. And we went back to the bank and said, we don't have money to renovate. So we got back the 30% deposit and used that as renovations.
I just reflect on that time. What did you take away from that? Do you think that that contributed to your future vision of doing what you're doing for a living?
You know, ever since I was a kid, I'm not sure if I ever want to be in real estate. But I always wanted to be in financial. So I later realized that real estate is just a tool for financial industry. So over the years, you can see that GLP is morphing from a brick and mortar real estate more and more into a fund management business. So we started our fund management business about 8 years ago with our first fund. And now we have a little over $65 billion of fund under management. And I think we expect to grow that probably another 10, 20 times.
Before we get further about GLP and your own experience, let's go back a little bit. You joined Prologis, and the CEO, Jeffrey Schwartz, saw a tremendous amount of potential in you, fast-tracking you to becoming the youngest MD in the company and responsible for growing China. You left the company along with Jeffrey in 2009. You partnered together with GIC as your financial backer to buy out China and Japan operations. Mm-hmm. Talk to us about that time and that decision to lead a buyout of a company along with somebody who had been your mentor and your friend as a co-partner in the business.
In 2008 financial crisis, my first priority was to make sure my team is intact. And so it was not a financial-driven decision. It was how to make sure my team's intact and that we have the capacity to continue to grow. So my first instincts, how to save the team and also the company. So I reached out to GIC and I said, here's an opportunity for you to own the crown jewel of Prologis, basically China and Japan. So we did that in December 2008. They wrote a check for $1.3 billion, and then 18 months later, we took it public and returned $6.6 billion value. So it was good for them. Going back to Jeff, he was a great friend and great mentor. We were more like brothers. And I would say that if you ever have experience running a business, a big business, it's very lonely at the top. I would highly recommend to find a partner that you can talk to. Sometimes, even if you don't have the solution to the problem, just the fact that you have someone to share the problem, the burden is already half gone. And but I would also say that partnerships is not easy because you have competition, jealousy. So you gotta find someone that you take pride in their accomplishment and their achievement and not in a competing situation. So if you can find that right partner, it's the best thing for a business, it's the best thing for you personally. I would highly recommend that.
I don't think it's overstating that Jeff was at one point the person you worked for.
Yeah.
He became your mentor, he became your friend, you became co-partners, but then sadly he passed. You acquired the business in 2009 and as co-CEOs of the business, he passed in 2014. Mm-hmm. What was that transition for you, moving from, as you just described, the partnership that you had with somebody you were very close to now being the sole leader of the organization?
Yeah, I would say it was a big change and a big challenge because, you know, for a while you have someone to always relate to and talk to. So when Jeff was gone, I went through a period of time where it was a hard adjustment. So what I had decided to do was to elevate and the rest of the team to where I view them equal partners. And so I think that change opens up for me to attract a lot of talent that I normally would not. They didn't want to work for anyone, but they don't mind to be my partner. So so we're able to assemble a very impressive global team of what I call partners. And also, I think finding like-minded friends and business colleagues to bounce off ideas to and to share. We face a lot of similar issues, and it's good to to have friends and that you trust and also peers you trust to have that does not have a conflict to bounce off these ideas. I think that was something that I if I ever look back I adjusted quite well.
And one of the things I liked about the story is you had the experience of having bought a business, mm-hmm. privately owned. You took it public, and you did take this business, GLP, public in 2010. But then in 2017, you led a consortium to take the business private again. Mm-hmm. Talk to us about that decision process. Why did you go public? And then why did you ultimately conclude that you wanted to go private again?
So in 2010, we went public, and we started a fund management business in 2011. Since we went public, all the capital that we required to grow was raised from private equity. We never raised any money from the public market. So it defeats the purpose of being public. And so what happened, the mistake we made was we were a China and Japan story, a single product to a single region. We expand into US, Brazil, and then we start investing in technology. It just got so complicated that each time we invest, the share price went down. So we decided it's probably better in a private setting.
You just made reference to it, but let's talk about global. You started with the China, and you started with China and Japan. You've expanded into Europe, into Brazil, into the US. What do you take away from that experience, and what would you share with this group about thinking beyond your original source and thinking about it as a global business?
It's interesting. Logistics is becoming a global phenomenon, but also from in our business, we think of in two set of customers. We have a set of customers that use our facility and our service, and then we also have another set of customers that give us capital to manage, and we manage on behalf of pensions, sovereign wealth funds. So we have two set of customers. We have customers in China that want to invest capital with us in China, but also they want to invest capital outside of China. And we have investors that invest with us from outside China into China, but also they want to invest the rest of the world. So we're basically leveraging capital partners on a global basis. But also logistic is also a business that you can translate globally. For instance, like we recently entered in India. We see a lot of potential that what have happened in the technology side on the logistics business, it could be translated into India. I think India is probably 10 years behind in many of the areas. So I think we can leverage that. We're also seeing, on the more mature business, we can learn from US and Europe, but on how to incorporate technology into the traditional logistics, it actually can be exported from China into the US, into Europe. We have invested in robotic companies that are designed and manufactured in Hangzhou, into Japan, into Europe, and also into US. So there's definitely a cross-border sharing that We see a lot of potential.
What's one of the hardest decisions that you've been faced with, or decisions, and how do you work your way through those decisions?
Yeah, that's, you know, I've looked back, some of my major decisions that I made at the crossroad is never about, I would say it's never about economics. I have this formula. So I basically said, okay, if I have two options, which option I make, doesn't matter good or bad outcome, give me the minimal regret. Because I can't quantify dollars, but I can quantify, if I don't do this, will I regret it? If I do this, it fails, will I regret it? And I'm just balancing which one minimizes my regret. Because at the end of the day, when we all die and you know, laying in the deathbed last minute, we're not gonna calculate how much money we have in our account. But we always wonder, what if, what could have? You know, you wanna minimize that. So my goal in life is minimize regret.
We titled this Out of the Box, and I think the reality is that had both elements to it. One is, many people think about real estate as the box, and that's used actually as part of the vocabulary, but I also think part of it was intended to recognize that you think about things differently.
Yeah.
I think you've talked about that in many ways, and I think for those of us, you know, looking to lead businesses or grow institutions, that's a critical component. Is there any other definition or other meaning that you would bring to out of the box is how you think about it?
Yeah, I think it's interesting. Most people that join our company, when they join, they thinking they're actually joining a logistic company, and they come in and spend some time. They say, actually, I'm in the real estate company, and then after a while, they realize, we're in the fund management business. And then after a while, we're actually in the logistic technology-driven business. So just to illustrate that is that I always don't see things constant. Once your business gets to a certain scale and size, there's a ability to create different business out of it. So for instance, like if I own one warehouse, I would be just a rent collector. But when I own, you know, 800 million square feet of warehouses globally, I create a fund management business out of it. And then I'm leveraging the warehouse as a connecting point to connecting the transportation and the goods that flow through it, and leveraging the financing to do supply chain financing. And then we also start leveraging investment, creating funds, investing in technology, internet of things on the robotics side to make sure that we can monitor all the goods. So we can start working with banks to provide financing on the goods that go through our warehouse as well. So it's interesting, once you get to a certain size and scale, you can start leveraging different aspects of technology and asset in place and create different revenue stream and different business out of it. So that's, I guess, out of box is quite appropriate because I never see a business should be constant. You should leverage whatever advantage you have and resources you have and create different business out of it and create value out of it.
Ming, really greatly appreciate. I appreciate you being with us today and honoring us with this discussion. So thank you very much.
It's an honor for me.
Thank you. Good.